Here's where things begin for real. I want to welcome people to this course, and I want to welcome people to the first series of lectures, which on the brain on neuroscience. And I want to begin this series of lectures and the course itself with a story about a man named Phineas Gage and an event that happened to Gage in the summer of 1848 in Cavendish, Vermont. So, Gage was a blessing foreman working on a railway construction project, and his job at that time was to clear away rock so that they could load the down tracks. And to do so, his routine during those days was that he would bore a hole in the rock. Inside the hole, he put blasting powder and a fuse. Then he would cover that up with dirt and sand and take a tumbling iron, which he carried with him. A big piece of steel looked like a javelin, and used it to tamp down the sand and dirt so that later they could set the fuse and cut the explosions. Well, one day something didn't work. Nobody exactly sure why. Maybe he just forgot to put in the sand and the dirt, but regardless, he put the tumbling iron into the hole, the powder explodes. The tumbling iron shot away from his hand and went into his face. It entered the left side of Gage's jaw, moving in upward direction, impact behind the left eye throughout the left side of the brain, and it went out the top of his skull and lunged several feet away of the splatter. Now, miraculously, Gage wasn't killed on the spot. He lost concision for a little bit, but then he staged to his feet. And in some regards, Gage was very lucky. So he underwent a series of operations. He had infection, he got sick. At times, his life was in risk. But months later, he was in certain regards pretty much recovered. He was able to see, he wasn't deaf, he wasn't paralyzed, he didn't lose the ability to speak or understand a language, he didn't lose his intellectual separatism in any simple way. But in another sense, Gage was very unlucky, because Gage has transformed by this incident. Someone who knew Gage described this transformation like this. Before the accident, Gage was quite the most efficient and capable man, a man of temperable habits, considerable measure of character, a sharp-shared businessman. After the accident, Gage was no longer Gage. He was fitful, irreverent, entering a time in the gross, profoundly magnificently, but little difference of his fellows. He ended up losing his job. He traveled throughout the states, taking up different jobs, engaging in different relationships, and ultimately ended up in an exhibit in a traveling circus, holding a tumbling iron and telling people about his terrible story, about how it went through his head and went through his brain and changed his life. So, why am I telling you this story? Well, as I said, I want to begin this course by talking about the brain. And the story of Phineas Gage illustrates something which we have abundant reason to believe, which is that the brain is the source of mental life. And so damage to the brain can have profound effects on who we are and what we are. And the deal here is nicely summarized by the Nobel Prize winning biologist Francis Crick. He calls it the Astonishing hypothesis. As right, the Astonishing hypothesis is that your joys and your sorrows, your manners and your ambitions, your sense of personal identity and free will are in fact no more than a behavior of a vast assembly of non-selves and their associated molecules. Now, this assembly of nerve cells is, of course, the brain, the brain and parts of the spinal cord, but we're going to talk about the brain here. And the idea then, as sometimes people like to put it, the mind is the brain, or that the mind is what the brain does of the mental life emerges from the brain. The official term of this is materialism, that we are... The official term for this is materialism, that we are material beings. Everybody accepts that our arms and legs and our heart and kidneys are made of the same sort of stuff as rabbits and automobiles and cops. But the idea is that our mental life that makes us special, our most intimate feelings and thought also arise. Also arise from these material things. And this is the idea that makes possible the discipline of neuroscience and much of psychology.